bankrupt cities for profit. Without further ado, I'd like to call upon the Prime Minister to open the case for Thai government in settlement. Hear, hear.
Which is about which is better for the for the bankrupt city that governed by the company or governed by the government. We believe that this debate is practical debate and which can manage the city, and we believe that company is the best actor to govern the bankrupt city. So this our model is one. The bankrupt city means bankruptcy and also long-term economic depression, for example, in Flint in Michigan or so forth. Second, auction of the rights to govern with location. If, for example, budget allocation, cutting subsidy program, or this decision to build infrastructure, or we would like to allow local government, local government to decide what kind of minimum requirements. But fourthly, to implement policy, like the regulation is okay for them. Also, then fifthly, we are okay with cooperation for forming group and collecting, purchasing the right to govern. This is our model. So firstly, I'd like to talk about what company have interest to buy those kind of cities. IT companies have incentive to purchase because they would be able to create smart city using their programs. For example, like all cities infrastructure is composed by their products or so forth. Therefore, secondly, for example, like consulting company have an incentive to, because they have profit from making infrastructure by using their company also. But thirdly, company have generally company have incentive if they can revitalize the city, they can massively improve their social image in the society, right? That is why their stock price will increase. Also, if they could achieve the revitalization, they can advertisement about this city. That is why their marriage power is significantly big that they can show into the society. We think this is the motivation for the company to buy those those cities. But then I would like to explain under the status quo, local governments do not have capacity to solve bankruptcy. So several reasons. Firstly, because they are easily affected by election, so they cannot conduct policy which are unpopular to our citizens, right? Because but it's necessary. For example, decreasing social welfare, so forth. But secondly, local government are affected by interest group and lobbyists, right? And cannot conduct necessary policy. For example, like local government affected by local farming union, so they cannot actually sell farming land to other factories or so forth. But thirdly, local government suffer from lack of competent human resources. Because they cannot pay high salary to gather good managers in their in another status quo. We think three reasons, local governments cannot actually have a capacity to solve bankrupt city. But that is why we propose this motion. So then I would like to explain why after taking prom we can solve those kind of situations. several reasons. Firstly, the corporations and corporation and group of corporations will be able to revitalize bankrupt economy. Several reasons. Firstly, these corporations will not be severely influenced by election, right? Because therefore they can conduct things or policies like cutting welfare programs or cutting subsidy programs, which are very unpopular policy for our citizens. We say that those kind of policy is a significantly benefit for to revitalize the city. We think this kind of policy is necessary for make a better city. But secondly, they can use the budget that they acquire to invest in conducting new infrastructure and to employ local citizens. Because, right? yes. But also that also thirdly, they themselves will be able to construct their own facility in local area. For example, Tesla will will be able to create their own factory in their area. That is why those citizens will be hired. And also because those kind of company exists in the area, we can get some tax from that company or factory. That is why we can actually improve our budget or revenue in our paradigm. Fourthly, the corporation will be able to decrease the regulation. for example, environmental regulation or so forth, which will make easy for other corporations to come and invest. We think this policy, decreasing regulation is significantly benefit for those both cities, because we can have more corporations and which will give us the tax money, right? We think those kind of tax money will make better our city. But fifthly, corporation would be able to allocate extremely competitive human resources and managers, because oftentimes they are global company. Therefore they can gather competent people from all over the world. We think those kind of human resources is significantly benefit for those cities, because we can have more people who have a much potential and much knowledge about the economy or so forth. That is why they can manage the companies the cities also. That is why in the consequence of the after DK program, we can practically save those kind of cities. That is why we propose this motion. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now I'd like to call upon the lead opposition to open the case for side opposition. The Senator is here. Here.
Checking is fundamentally necessary to balance out economic gain and minimum right. And we think that even if the corporation want to seek their own profit, they never ever care their own local citizens. And we think this kind of based on the citizen will, the democracy and the governance of the country should be taken. That is a clear stance coming from the negative side. We're going to talk about two issues in my speech. Firstly, the alternative model coming from the opposition side, and secondly, why the private corporation tends to be abusive and why the democratic governance is better. So based on that, so let's talk about the opposition's model. Firstly, we think we are going to continue the such kind of democratic governance of the citizen. We think that based on the citizen's will, that take the maybe newer economic policy or such kind of continuing the welfare policy, that we think this should be decided by the citizen. We think that this kind of new economic policy maybe that include this kind of, for example, making the city as a such kind of special economic zone, like for example creating casino or creating resort town, or like for example tax exemption on one particular company in order to attract such kind of other company to go into the country. And we think if necessary, such kind of national government are more than happy to bail out, which means the inject cashes or the budget of the budget of their local government. We think this kind of the monetary problem can be solved, this kind of bailout and our alternative model. We think this kind of situation is fundamentally important because we think the governance is particularly important because like that this is based on the such kind of political decision. Like for example, relax of the labor law or like for example such kind of immigration policy in order to get the workers. We think this kind of free control by if this kind of political decision can be controlled by this private corporation, we think the abusive condition happening. This will be explained by my second argumentation. So secondly, why this kind of private corporation tends to be abusive? Firstly, let's take a look at the realistic characterization of this kind of private corporation, which is more likely to go into this kind of bankrupt city. This they characterize as like, for example, IT in the IT corporation, like for example, consultant industry. We think this is particularly unrealistic characterization because we think if this is not such kind of bankrupt city, like for example, they may be such kind of less accessible to the public transportation system, or like for example, less accessible from the Shinkansen railway, or like for example, from the airport. We think in this situation, this kind of the good talent person, as they characterize, is really coming to this situation because the good talent person who has active role in the IT industry is necessary to go to the second metropolis. In order, and that's why this is necessary to public transport system. But the, as motion said, this is bankrupted city. The reason of bankrupted city is this kind of necessary environment is lacked in the first places. That's why realistically, the realistic characterization is rather such kind of manufacturer industry, which is want to create large factory within, and based on this kind of factory, they want to create this kind of large manufacturing system. We think this is a realistic, that highly likely characterization of outside the house. Yes.
That's exactly why IT companies would probably form a union with construction company to build roads and build trains in order to build their smart city.
We think that in the context of the city, we think the city is not such kind of related to this kind of other area, which is to connect to the transportation, connect to the other area, which cannot be influenced by the governance of the one particular city. We think this is this is not that such kind of proper characterization. So based on that, what is happening? Firstly, that we think that this kind of private corporation do not have a motivation to the reflect the citizens' will, because we think they want to seek their own profit. They want to follow the such kind of opinion of their stockholders rather than the cities. May if citizens' will match to the company's will, this may be increase happiness. But in many cases, the citizens' will are not such kind of followed by the company because this kind of the environmental regulation or the labor law regulation is often trade-off with the citizens' happiness in the first places. Because if this kind of abusive condition happening, we think the citizens are not happy in the first places. A second characterization of this kind of city, citizens are not mobile. Even if this kind of a company starts the abusive policy in the first places, because firstly, the reason very simple evidence is even though this city is already bankrupted, still citizens that we are talking about still remaining citizens, which means that they have maybe such kind of psychological attachment to the city, or maybe this kind of financial problem which enable them to move to other cities. We think that's why citizens are not mobile. That's why even if this kind of company become abused, these kind of citizens, we see even in this situation, they cannot move to other area and they cannot register this kind of citizen in the first place. We think this is particularly significant situation because power imbalance between private corporation, which govern the city and these kind of citizens are significantly happening. We think this is massively significant situation. So what is the exact harm we are talking about? Firstly, we think as a result of seeking the profit, they try to decrease the section labor regulation as minimum as possible. We think in this particular situation, like for example, long-term working hours or the simple labor, or like for example, low-wage laboring the citizen is happening. We think in this situation, and this kind of list, particularly in terms of simple labor of the factory, we think this situation it's happening. And even if citizens want to remove the citizen can remove the register this kind of situation, they can introduce such kind of like for example, foreign cheap workers by their own political decision. we think this situation is massively harmful because these kind of labor are often replaceable by this kind of allowing the political decision, by allowing the foreign immigrant labor. We think this situation is massively damaging to the citizens' environment. So secondly, in terms of security problem, maybe such kind of surround the factory, not such kind of entire city, this kind of the security camp or the police allocation is taken, but we think as long as the factory company only care about their own corporation, we think this kind of allocation of the other side of the city cannot be taken. We think this situation is massively problematic because simply the security of the other cities, other area cannot be guaranteed except for such kind of the factory is concentrated area. We think this is significantly damaging the citizens' rights. And thirdly, we say in terms of environmental regulation, we think this is also, they do not have the motivation. They may be follow the certain minimum rule, but they never ever not have the motivation to improve this kind of environmental regulation, which is fundamentally necessary for the citizens' health. Fourthly, we think in terms of welfare distribution, we think this is can be taken by the citizens' will if they have the if they take the economic policy, but they want to vote the welfare policy they in the next election, they can require welfare distribution, but the company never ever have that motivation to give the welfare, even if they need such kind of livelihood protection to protect the street people, the people on in the street, they do not do that. We think this is significant situation we are very proud to oppose.
Thank you very much. Now I call upon the Deputy Prime Minister to extend the government case in 7 minutes. Hear, hear.
No pain, no gain. That is what we have to recognize on the specific problem we face. The government can take pain in terms of the people's will, in terms of the representation, in terms of accountability. That is the reason the cities cannot escape from the living hell. And that is why in their paradigm, the people and government negatively force people to living in destructive and awful situation. That is what we propose. My speech I'm going to talk about, I will deal with the reputation and engagement of my previous speaker. Firstly, about their model and also about human abuses. And suddenly I'm going to explain about accountability. I will reconstruct my personal explanation about accountability. Why government is awful? Because the government is accountable to citizens. That is why they have to respond to the will of the citizen anytime. That is why they can't escape from the disruptive situation. And that this motion only can solution to solve those problems. Okay, first of all, engagement. And first model, they say that national government bailout, so it's okay. But it is uncertain to begin with. Firstly, this motion just say that we shift the governance to the profit companies. To begin with, there is no bailout from the national companies and national government. There is not guarantee that those things gonna happen. And so that's why they have the burden. That's why realistically national bailout will happen to begin with. And also national parliaments, there's many interests have to begin with. And some people think that bailout is not so good things to begin with. And why we can use tax to falling cities. Those the interests also happen, also occurring in the parliament. Why national bailout will inevitably and definitely happen or occur in their parliament? That's the burden of truth. And sadly, even if those discussion happen in the parliament, but we need long discussion to take consent in the bailout to begin with. And this, the long term and prolonging the discussion is fatal because those city is falling even day by day to begin with. So that's why even if those bailout happen, it is too late to begin with. So that's why they cannot guarantee any kinds of revitalization to begin with. Secondly, about the human abuse, and they said the balance of economy and the human rights is very important. And after taking the crown, the definitely human abuse happen, it is awful. First of all, even if the private company have to follow the law, and in the past space, a federal law or Japanese law or anything like that. So that's why minimum standard is guaranteed to begin with. So that's why radical abuse never happened to begin with. And secondly, if a company have themselves have the incentive not to abuse the people because the people criticize if very serious abuse happen, and media broadcast those things, and stakeholders of those companies fear rumor or recognition of those society things, and they pressurize not to abuse people to the company who own those cities and who govern those cities. And so that's why it is unrealistic. And also they say that about the security, companies also secure some surrounding companies area only that, and that's why it is for the security it is so totally bad. But same logic happened. If those things happen, also criticized by many people, and that also if the riot happened in the area, in those isolated area, it is very difficult to govern the cities for the company themselves. So that's why they have the responsibility and also incentive to respond and not to take those things in the first place. So that's why the very serious abuse is unrealistic and totally doesn't stand in their paradigm, in our paradigm to begin with. And secondly, that even if to some extent that some harm happened, but government itself, that we already contextualized the situation, the problem, government and the status quo cannot sustain welfare to begin with. So that's why comparatively it is better to begin with, even in terms of the human rights. And also, that even if the short term, the pay, it is painful, but it is necessary to revitalize those cities, even if to some extent human rights is violated in short term. But and their paradigm, because they care about short term human rights, so that's why they cannot solve the fundamental problem of the city, and can't solve revitalize the city in long term. If they keeping the status quo and just care about the human people's demand in short term, in the end, the time is too late, and we cannot irreversibly that we cannot reconstruct those cities and people. And in the end of the day, people suffer from the living hell in the first place. So that's why we have to prioritize the profit. We have to prioritize economy now in this debate. Okay, let's move on to accountability. And we believe that because the government is accountable, have to accountable to the people, that is the obstacle of revitalizing those cities. Firstly, they have to care about many kinds of the needs and the needs of the people on the ground, on the city. To begin with, what city people need, they're definitely looking at their daily life, and if some kind of the bad things happen to their daily life, they refuse that, and some revitalization plan of those cities looks too painful for the people on the ground. But it is necessary, but people on the ground cannot understand and they prioritize their daily life, so that's why they refuse. On this situation, people and the government cannot take the necessary plan to revitalize the cities and long-term the solution to save the people to begin with. That is the problem we are facing now. And secondly, even if the majority of people resist or follow the government, the explanation, but still it is problematic because the government also have to accountable to many interests. That they said we can establish a casino or anything things, but if the casino pressurizes some kind of the store or some kind of the people who have the interest in those cities, that they are lobbying to the politician and not to take casino, not to open casino, or those kind of things often happen in that situation. And also government have to accountable and government influenced by those needs in the first place. So that's why it is very difficult to conduct the policy to begin with, even if it is necessary. And at least we can, at least that they cannot guarantee any kind of the basic the policy to respond to such long term the problem. And why in our paradigm we can succeed? Because the companies are only accountable for the stakeholders. Only the stakeholders just need the results, in meaning the revitalization of the city. Because without the revitalization, they cannot get money, and also company can't get money. And in order to survive, they have the strong motivation and only solely motivation to take action and take policy, even if it is to some extent painful for the people on the ground. But they can do this, and it is beneficial and it is useful in the long term to revitalize people. In the end of the day, it is also beneficial for the people on the ground because their future is guaranteed because of the revitalization. In order to save people, we are extremely proud to send the proposition.
Thank you very much, Deputy Prime Minister. Now I'd like to call upon the Deputy Lead Opposition to extend the opposition case in 7 minutes. Hear, hear.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We think democratic check is just too important that no states, no governments, as liberal democracies, should give up. We don't think people's minimum rights should rest in the hands of ugly and unkind private companies. And that is precisely why we oppose this motion. Ladies and gentlemen, we're talking about the most vulnerable people, people who made the decision to stay in Yubari City, to live in under the minimum payment, ladies and gentlemen. And what government side of Adam does is that you decrease that minimum because you don't have any democratic check. On our side of the house, we're happy to agree that after a long discussion, many of the population in Yubari City may agree to lower down the minimum wage a little bit. Because if they agree that is their minimum, their new standard of minimum, we are fine with that. But what happens on their side of the house is that there's no check and balance, there's nowhere to stop the decrease of that minimum wage. And that is the harm we are really, really, really worried about. And we don't really think that government has given us sufficient analysis to tell us why that these private companies would care about it. So I'm going to talk about three things. I'm firstly sorry to analyze what we have provided on as alternatives, but secondly, I'm going to note it down. Talk about how we don't think private companies have an incentive to govern these nations, these cities properly and in an unabusive manner. And thirdly, I'm going to talk about harms, massive harms that occur by taking this policy. So firstly, about alternatives. Now, everything they have mentioned wasn't really like a benefit or unique to this motion about selling. They just told us that multinationals would come if this minimum wage would become a little bit smaller, and they would form groups and they would build us infrastructure because it is necessary for the governments. So what is really the difference between bailing out and, or for example, making decisions to make that Yubari City an economic zone, a specialized economic zone, to call multinationals? Government, and we think government has always the motivation to make the decision in order to make the decision of these kind of things. If they are willing to make decisions to sell it, we think these decisions can also be made. But secondly, the criticism coming from government was that, well, these decisions take a lot of time. In order to bail out, it takes a lot of time. We think their policy takes a lot of time too. In order to make the decision on which city to sell, ladies and gentlemen, we think there needs a democratic decision, like a negotiation in the first place. So we don't really think these in terms of time, the two sides are that different in the first place. But secondly, ladies and gentlemen, what happens, when you sell and give up democracy and give private companies the right to rule, is that they wouldn't set up infrastructures everywhere as a recognized right universally upon people living in that Yubari City. They would only set up infrastructure that is necessary for the basic running of factories, ladies and gentlemen. So they would create a road in front of the factory to the ports, maybe to the airports, and then nowhere else. We think that arbitrary distinction is just wrong because we think infrastructure minimum rights your own the minimum standard of living is a God-given right that everybody should have. But secondly, in terms of would these companies have the motivation to run these cities properly, we don't think they would be. My partner also already analyzed how these are profit seekers, to which government has given us two responses. Firstly, they have told us that. These companies have the motivation to increase their brand image or whatever. Now the thing is, that doesn't really necessarily mean that these companies would provide good infrastructure everywhere, because we think companies don't necessarily spend a lot of money on CSR activities. Many multinationals spend about 2% of their gross income annually on CSR activities, just to show that they are giving us minimum engagement to social responsibility. On the other hand, they spend like 50% of their gross annual income on advertisements on things like the technology or the brand image, or to payments on celebrity figures to come up in the TV commercial that they have. We don't think that CSR activities are like the core motivation to make companies act properly. Second thing was criticism. People would criticize and then companies would hate that. First of all, a case study. Like international community criticized Nike for running a sweatshop in Thailand. A lot of people initially, for like 1 month, boycotted buying Nike shoes, ladies and gentlemen. 3 months later, what happened? It was that people started buying it again. Why? Because people, firstly, are likely to forget things when they see other news in the first place. So secondly, we think that these multinational companies, which are big enough to come in and buy, they have a strong brand image. Brand images often come over these realities, which are unfortunate but true, ladies and gentlemen. So we think that the result of that is that it means that the conditions may be, due to criticism, become a little bit higher. But the thing is, because it isn't decided democratically, there's no check and balance on whether that improvement is what people really wanted and needed. That's the difference between these two sides, ladies and gentlemen. So also, we tell you that there is no motivation for these companies. Even if companies has made the city larger, ladies and gentlemen, we don't really think it necessarily trickles down to the people. Maybe because they have the right to control taxation policies, they will lower down corporate tax and then increase income tax in order to abuse citizens more and make that company look larger in terms of the profit that they earn. Ladies and gentlemen, we think private companies, given the control, are absolutely dangerous. So what have we analyzed in terms of abuse? We have told you about safety, we have told you about environmental harms and all these kind of things. We have told you about taxation. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is very dangerous because economic gains is very easy to justify to the people because it looks like they are trying to pursue results. Even democratic government sometimes does it. But the difference is that people can't say anything against it and people can't escape. My partner analyzed how people can't escape. We are talking about people who have like a psychological attachment to these people. People who are willing to stay even though Yubari City has been in bankruptcy for like 10 years. We're talking about people who have no money to start a new life, get a new job in somewhere else. Ladies and gentlemen, also we would point to the fact that what happens if a foreign company buys these cities? If I was a Chinese government, I would have every incentive to buy Yubari cities, put military forces there, in the name of police forces, and all, as a threat to Japan, to control Japan's activity, setting missiles in order to show that we are always willing to attack your nation. Ladies and gentlemen, we think all these harms can accrue because we give out democratic check to private hands. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'd like to call upon the government whip to conclude the government case in 7 minutes. Hear, hear.
Mr. Speaker, the fundamental failure of today's affirmative negative team is the lack of mechanism. They didn't really respond to the specific mechanism of how local governments are influenced by election, they're influenced by lobby organization, they're incapable of acquiring competent individuals. But moreover, they didn't really explain to our mechanism how we're going to improve the situation, how corporations will be able to build their own factories in those regions, how corporations will be able to attract other corporations by easing certain things such as environmental policies or like labor policies. There was absolutely no engagement on that. That's the first failure. But the second failure is that the lack of explanation of the alternative things that they propose. Bailouts, structural, special economic zone. Okay, we understood the word, but what did they really mean by that? What are they going to implement? How is that going to improve places such as Flint, places such as Detroit? So yes, they did give like a number of responses to our case, but they didn't really give the crucial important mechanism of our case, and that is why they're going to fail in today's debate. So I only have one issue to really sum up today's debate. Will cooperation be able to better revitalize crippling economy, or will there be harm? And the before we move on to that, the thing that we have to recognize is that they were unable to prove how the current situation will be able to self-solve itself. We talked about how all the structural problems of the local government unresponded by the negative team. We talked about how the alternative mechanism would probably not work. Again, no response from the alternative team. So even if our policy won't be able to perfectly solve every single situation, the worst case scenario is that this is the status quo. So at that moment, we think that we already win today's debate. So moving on to my issue. How will we improve situation? We gave you four fundamental logic, right? One, these corporations won't be influenced by election, therefore they will be able to conduct things such as easing welfare programs, easing subsidies program to a reasonable level, and in order to improve their fiscal situation. No response. Second was that corporations will be able to build and construct factories and bases of operations in places such as Flint, in places such as Detroit, in order to employ and hire local residents there. Again, no response. Three, corporations will be able to like ease environmental regulations and labor law in order to attract like foreign companies and other companies in order to operate in those regions. Again, there was no response. Fourthly, we talked about how corporations are better able to attract like more competent personnel, more competent manager, because oftentimes the operation of these corporations are global, so they can acquire individuals from all around the world. Again, there was no response on that. We think that's a crucial failure coming from the negative team. On to their alternative, like special economic zones and bailout. Now, fundamentally, as my partner told you, like, fundamentally, in order to understand special economic zone, what happens is probably you're going to decrease corporate tax, and oftentimes what happens is you decrease labor law, you decrease minimum wage. That's what happened in places such as Hong Kong, that's what happens in places such as Dai Lang. So the consequence of their like alternative is not so different from the worst consequence of our paradigm. But the big distinction is you cannot guarantee their solution, bailout, special economic zone. What happens if people don't agree to that? What happens if people say, we don't want to decrease our minimum wage, so we're not going to implement special economic zone? That means their alternative will not work and won't be achieved, and so their alternative mechanism is really uncertain. So the benefit that they try to achieve in the status quo is again uncertain, ladies and gentlemen. But moreover, ladies and gentlemen, sit down. These kind of alternative solution is not guaranteed because unfortunately there are many failing cities. There are many bankrupt cities, and when you take a look at countries such as the United States, places such as Flint, Michigan, places such as Detroit, Michigan, ladies and gentlemen, and the government simply do not have enough capacity to save each and every single failing cities. So they had to explain to us why the United States government, which already is suffering from a crippling economy itself, will be able to save like every and bail out every single failing city in its country. Sit down. They talked about how check and balances is fundamentally important in democracy, but they didn't really make it a practical argument. We say that speed is far much more important, especially in today's particular context, because if it takes a long time to even acquire enough consent to decrease minimum wage. Now, if it takes too much speed, what happens is that companies will see that, like foreign companies will see that, and they will be pessimistic about that situation and will say that probably situation won't come. So therefore, their investment will probably go to other places where the improvement is much more higher in speed, ladies and gentlemen. Their response to this was to say, well, the affirmative team model will also take time. One, they misunderstand our model, right? Because we're not saying that we're going to have any democratic election prior to like local government selling the right to govern to corporations. So we're more than happy for government themselves to decide on that. Sit down. But second of all, like, even if that is the case, even if it takes like time at the initial point of selling and auctioning off this particular right, after that, like implementing every single policy, building infrastructure, like easing up environmental regulation, that the speed required after the purchase has been concluded is much more smaller than the speed that they require in their paradigm. I'll take you in a moment. Company, but what we further talked about is that company will be able to implement abusive policy because they only care about their stockholder. First of all, there's going to be like minimum limits upon that, because obviously we're talking about local government, meaning that they won't be able to change federal laws such as immigration or security. But second of all, they won't be able to like conduct like absolutely abusive policy, because if they do so, their corporate reputation goes down. And what happens when corporate reputation goes down is that their stock price goes down. Their response from the deputy was that, well, people forget about worse things such as Nike and those kind of things. The Nike example supports our case, because yes, ultimately people forgot, but the important thing to remember is that sweatshop stopped. Nike stopped using sweatshop and the situation improved, and that is a massive benefit. Yes.
Okay, if you think our solution is not guaranteed, what is your guaranteeness of your solution? Because Beta and having future potential company actually join the auction and buy these kind of problematic cities.
I understand. We understand that we will never be able to prove 100% feasibility, but we gave you a host load of logic why corporations are more competent in improving the situation, which they never engage, so they already lose in today's debate. Moreover, they talked about how like corporations will prioritize their own places, like only sending police to their location, prioritizing to build infrastructure in their location. This is not true, because in order to revitalize regional economy, you need each and every function of that local regional economy to operate, such as sewage, such as roads, and such as hospital. So that's the uniqueness of like governance, right? You need a comprehensive solution to the entire thing. So in order to succeed, corporations must solve every single thing. But second of all, even if that is true, it's already better than the alternative, or it's already better than the status quo, because at least people living in the surrounding area, close to that area, will be able to improve the situation. Ladies and gentlemen, the problem with the negative theme is that the lack of explanation of the mechanism of the alternative and justification of the status quo. The worst case scenario of our case is the status quo. That is why we win.
Thank you very much. We'll call from the option with. We conclude the option case 7. Here, here.
Fundamental business of local governance is just not just to ensure the basic economic functions of cities. Its basic job includes distribution of welfare, establishment of public institutions like schools, ensuring the local security by setting up police stations, and checking the toxic level of waters or distribution of electricity and gases, or those things. The point we emphasize in this debate is that provision of these public goods should be universal and fair over the cities overall. We think there's no explanation in the government side as to why the companies are incentivized, not just to they put the overall budget for these things, but to allocate them in the areas of the cities which need these public goods. There was no explanation about the motivational point about that. So profit-seeking corporations have no incentive, we say, for this universal provision of public goods and the harm which met no response from them. There are two issues I'd like to talk about. Firstly, the capacity of local public government under our paradigm, and secondly, what's the good about their case. So, firstly, the capacity of the local public government.
Pointer.
No, thank you. So, the Prime Minister gave us three analyses about why status quo sucks. So, firstly, the politicians are influenced by election, because unpopular policies like cutting budget for welfare will not be passed under status quo. So, then they concede from the first speaker the governance in the government's case will be insensitive to the very basic needs that any residents are entitled to, right? We believe these like budget cut policies will go beyond the pay under their paradigm. For example, livelihood protections will be lost in the worst case, which would result in the immediate destruction of people's rights, right? So politicians, on the other hand, we say, no thank you, politicians being checked by election is really necessary, especially when the period of governance itself is so long term. For example, 30 or 40 years of the lowest level livelihood protection might be expected under their case, right? How many people will die out before the recovery of city somehow is achieved? No thank you. There was no like, clear explanation about that. Secondly, they talked about the interest groups affecting the local government. This is just a rhetorical play, right? Firstly, we say their policy is essentially the same, right? They are replacing the interest group in the interest groups in the status quo with one big interest group governing the city, right? So there's no essential difference. No, thank you. Secondly, the elected government is still better under our paradigm in securing the basic needs of residents, even if they were influenced by interest groups, right? Because as the government suggested, the politicians will care about the eventual number of votes, which means if the local residents are so caring about their basic needs, then those local citizens are willing to vote for the politicians who are representing for their wills, then the local government under our paradigm will be sensitive to those basic needs. Thirdly, they talked about the lack of human resource. Those kind of things. So there aren't any alternative to this, Mr. Speaker, right? Those cities can call for any public financial advisors and administrative advisors outside the city to consult effective reformation plans. Why do you assume in this way that cities can only depend on itself in our paradigm? We think there is no justification for that assumption in the first place, and city can rely on any other public actors outside the cities. So secondly, no, thank you. Then they said there would be no mechanism under our paradigm about external bailouts or any other external supports. So we say if they love the mechanism of criticism, we think criticism is more effective under our paradigm, right? So criticism for failure of providing public goods would be more effective vis-a-vis public actors, the business of which is to provide public goods, because the state bears a role of providing the public goods, and this is consensual throughout the country, right? Anybody knows the state is responsible for providing public goods, and if it fails to do that, the local governments will be criticized, and we think that not only local governments, but external actors, which is not helping these local actors, will be criticized for failing to provide public goods. So this will, that mechanism of criticism will work under our paradigm. Any POI?
Yes. We agree that public goods should be universal, but again, you never give any specific mechanism of how that universal provision is achieved in the status quo when you take a look at places such as Flint, Michigan, or Detroit.
Right, you are just throwing examples, right? Well, I've just responded to all of your analysis in this first issue. So the second issue is what's good about government's case. So the basic thing coming from the government side is that there will be motivation of these companies to revitalize the cities. We say no. What corporations are motivated for is to export a part of their businesses to these cities, right? Corporations are satisfied with security and stability of these exported businesses, right? Not the general and universal well-being of local residents. So the first thing coming from them is construction facilities, such as government we've said, if IT corporations and construction corporations cooperate to establish roads and other infrastructure. We say this is no response to our imperative that provision of public goods should be universal. For example, roads may be built, or electricity or water or gases might be built, but they are built in areas that the corporations are expected to use in order to run its own business. So it will be near factories, it will be near the business offices, but it will be far away from these things, right? So, for example, the same thing can be said about police stations. Corporations will not be incentivized to set up a police station in areas so distant from their business offices and the residences for the workers of the corporation, right? So there will be little incentive for corporations to provide these things universally. And deeply Prime Minister said that priority was short-term economic gains. And so, first thing, they said even in short-term, the corporation will not sacrifice too much because they care about criticism. So we think criticism will easily arise against cut-offs to social welfare budget, which they expected in this debate. If the government says that corporations can so easily hesitate to cut welfare budget for the sake of reputation, then nothing different will be happening under their paradigm. But secondly, corporations will not care about the details of how they spend on needs. For example, they can just say, we are putting money on basic security by setting a police station overall. But what they are showing is how much money they spent overall, not whether they are putting police officers in slum areas, for example, right? Finally, they say, in short term, economic gains must be bigger under the government's paradigm. So, We say, once you give a long-term right to govern a city to public private actors, there is no guarantee that these corporations shift their policy focus from economic gains to stable social minimums, right? Because they eventually care about the balance sheets. They eventually care about the black letters on the balance sheets, and they will not reduce the profits vis-a-vis their costs. So that is the basic incentive of corporations, and that is the basic reason why corporations will fail to govern these cities. That's why we oppose. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Let's call upon option reply. You're here.
No pain, no gain. This rhetoric sounds nice, but what we need to understand in this debate is pain will be imposed on the citizens, but gain is come to the private corporation which govern the cities. We think that this situation is particularly unacceptable because what's the ultimate goal of their side of devitalization is make the citizen happier, the status save the citizen, but actually the citizen will not be saved under their policy. We think this is particularly problematic. Two things in summary. Firstly, in terms of solution of both sides, and secondly, the harm of the both sides. So firstly, in terms of solution of both sides, we provided the analysis, the alternative model, which is maybe deny this explanation from our side, but rely on the capture, their mechanism. Because mainly our mechanism of alternative, especially economic zone, is relaxing the, this kind of intact, relaxing labor regulation, or such kind of tax, relaxing the imposing tax regulation in exemption. We think under the, in this situation, their burden proof is rather their side of the house. Because what is the exclusive difference of this kind of relaxing tax by the government and by this kind of auctioning the city? We think as long as they fail to prove that, we think, oh, even if we actually voluntarily explain the mechanism, we think still our alternative is strongly damaging their cases. So the only responses to their side, from their side of the house, is possibility and time gap. We think the same the lack of possibility or existence of time gap is particularly applicable to the affirmative model. Because what we need to assume from affirmative model is surprise, when we are deciding the auction that this city, surprisingly there is such kind of company who seek the, this kind of particular factory places, and surprisingly this is very suitable for this kind of problematic cities, and they can compare, overcome this kind of comparison between creation on the developing country, then they make the cities. They are auctioned by the cities. We think this is very, very only potential and possibility level problem. We think this is not that guaranteed same as our alternative, ladies and gentlemen. We think in this situation, we cannot guarantee their model is so suitable, so sure compared with our side. We think this is particularly problematic. And second problem with their model, and exclusively different from our model, is they never ever prove that how that this kind of benefit, economic benefit, is trickled down to the citizens, not to the city, not to the such kind of company, because we think the economic benefit is never ever go to this kind of corporate, this kind of citizens' welfare, rather such kind of enhancing the innovation, rather enhancing the technology of the company. We think this is not proven, that's why citizens' life will never ever change. And in terms of wages of the local workers, we already mentioned that such kind of they have no motivation to introduce such kind of foreign immigrant workers, which is more cheaper wage. We think in this particular situation, citizens just lose a job in this kind of corporation dominated city working in Chinese labor. We think under this kind of situation, they have to go on the street without welfare. We think under this situation, this is very, very pitiful situation. We shouldn't accept that. That's why we say in terms of solution, even if mechanism itself is not that different, we think this is exclusively different of our side of the house. Secondly, in terms of harm, the problem of their side of the house is that our harm is particularly untouched. Just mentioned that just using the rhetoric, the pain is necessary in order to achieve the gain. We think this is not true because we think that only response is just criticism. We already mentioned that such kind of Nike's issues, and Uchiyama-san mentioned that such kind of criticism works, but we think sweatshop slightly changed the condition, but still abusive environment continue. Because this kind of continuation of the abusive environment is not criticized by these kind of customers. We think this situation is rather our policy of this kind of democratic decision actually change this kind of situation. Not just criticism, but such kind of actual election change the situation. We think that's why our harm harm on the welfare, a harm on the society, a harm on security, a harm on the harm of this kind of the quality of the environment. We think this harm is clearly stands. That's why I said this is exclusively different from outside the house. We are very proud to oppose.
Thank you very much, opportunity to reply. Finally, I'd like to call upon the government to reply to this debate in 4 minutes. Chair, chair.
Honorable Chair, ladies and gentlemen, this house. If we cannot solve financial problem of fallen city, they fall into the bottom of the world. No welfare, no economy, no right, no human decent life on there. So with the consensus of this debate is that we have to solve this problem. But unfortunately, this opposition didn't sufficiently explain about the problem solution. They just say there's some solution of ambiguous and uncertain, so that's why we propose this motion. My speech to summarize this debate, I'm going to explain two things. Firstly, about the solution. Secondly, about balance of economy and right of the people. Firstly, about the solution. And they said that even their power and people can choose the sufficient policy and those policies will be succeed. But we already said too that people will prioritize the pain of the today, even if the tomorrow the very serious situation is waiting to begin with. And also the people who have the specific interest in the city, about the businesses, they will oppose because their plan is the economic zone or casino or those things that dramatically change the business style of those cities, and people who have the old business on this town, on this city, is pressurized by those new businesses and definitely oppose those new policy to begin with, and there's no explanation why they can conduct those policies. And also they said about national bailout will completely defeat this policy, this analysis to begin with, and also in the real context, Detroit, Uvalde, any kind of foreign city, get the massive support from the national government to begin with, but they fall and they fail to begin with. They didn't recognize the reality of this war to begin with. And even if they can succeed to conduct a good policy, but why the government is the unique and better actor to carry out those policy, they didn't explain anything about those things. We said about experience, about knowledge, about the human resources, about about their incentive, the pursuit, the revitalization. In all circumstances and all factors, the company is better, and also those economic benefit is trickled down to also the citizen, because those companies also have the incentive to follow the law and also follow the demands of the people to in the level of the rational extent to begin with. So that's why definitely the company is better actor, and in terms of the solution of this severe problem, we are better than this opposition. Secondly, about the balance and economy of the people, and balance of economy and human rights. Today's opposition insists on the human life standard or human's will, and that sounds very nice, and we principally want to agree with them, but the practical not followed, unfortunately. And the status quo in the real world, that those governments not fail to guarantee the sufficient welfare to begin with, they didn't respond to this point. And the status quo, their welfare, their will not fulfilled to begin with, and how to solve this problem is the issue of this debate, but they neglect those things. And if we lose now, the people will fall into more serious situations in the first place, and we have to force people to struggle in the more serious living hell to begin with. So that's what we have to change now. But today, just given that throwing up some ambiguous solution, and they refuse to debate on this point, that is the failure of this today's opposition. We continuously say that only the pain can get the benefit, and today's opposition say that no pain, no gain is not true. But again, no pain, no gain to begin with. And they chasing the two rabbits and fail in the end of the day. And we just explain and we calculate the reality in order to save the people in the future, in order to definitely save in the future and long term the people's life. And we compromise the pain, and we show you the realistic way to solve and reconstruct those foreign cities. So that's why we're actually proud in standing in proposition. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to all the team.